libel or reckless handling of sensitive national security information. But I'll return to her a little bit later. I want to talk a little bit about the world and why it's so dangerous. I sit on both the Intelligence and the Armed Services Committee in the Senate. We conduct a lot of our business behind closed doors in classified settings. I've learned a lot about situations around the world. I've learned a lot about U.S. policy towards those situations over the last year. I didn't know it before then. When you look around the world and you see all the danger posed, you may think it's as dangerous as it's ever been. I can tell you, it's not as bad as it appears. It's much worse. And I wish I was joking, but I'm not. The world has grown greatly more dangerous over the last 7 years. In fact, I'll tell you a little story from the home front to reflect just how dangerous it's become. Many of you have met my father. My father was a Vietnam veteran. You may know that in 2004, when I was joining the Army, he wasn't thrilled about the concept. He knew what it was like to be in war. My mother knew what it was like to have a loved one go off to combat as well. She wasn't thrilled either. I said at the time that I wanted to go serve my country. I loved it. I wanted to go fight for it, the way he had taught me. That wasn't working with him. I said, how can it be a mistake to serve your country in time of war? He didn't have a good answer to that question, so he normally swarm off and cuff. I told him, they attacked us on 9/11 in New York and in Washington. What makes you think we're not next? We live a few miles from Nuclear One and Power Plant Rustville. What makes you think they won't try to attack us there? And he said, son, you need to lighten up. Well, this last year, my father, the first time in his 7 years on this earth, got a concealed carry permit. And he now carries a firearm with him on most days. I said, why'd you do that, Dad? Why did you argue with your concealed carry permit? Why do you carry a firearm? And he said, someone has to defend us if ISIS comes over here to cut our heads off. That's how serious this is, and that's how dangerous the world has become. And why has the world become so dangerous? It's because Barack Obama's foreign policy is impotent. Barack Obama has continually negotiated with, granted concessions to, underestimated our enemies, and disregarded and upended our alliances. Just look around the world at what happened in the last few days with the Islamic State. We've been attacked repeatedly by Islamic terrorists here in the United States, not just on 9/11, but before that as well in the First World Trade Center bombing, most recently in San Bernardino, places like Garland, Texas. There was a terrorist that attacked a recruiting station in Little Rock 6 years ago that killed young men who were trying to join our army, wounded them. The president has consistently underestimated them, called them the JV team, said they were on the run, said they were contained. Tell that to the Americans who were blown to death in Brussels last week, or the over 300 people who were murdered or maimed there. Tell that to the 70-plus Christians in Lahore, Pakistan. Like many of us, like Anna and Gabriel, celebrating his first Easter, going to church, going to their farm, then going to the park where Christians were celebrating Easter, and they were blown to pieces by a suicide bomber. Not because of anything they had done, they were their fellow countrymen from Pakistan, because they were Christians who refused to submit to the radical ideology of groups like the Islamic State and Al-Qaeda. What did Barack Obama do last week? He went to a baseball game and did the wave with Raul Castro. He sat in the stands and gave an interview to ESPN next to Derek Jeter, wearing sunglasses. Said that Big Poppy, Dave Ortiz, the designated hitter for the Red Sox, said it right when he said that we have to go about our business, that we can't be deterred by terrorists. I agree. But Big Poppy is the designated hitter. His job is to hit home runs and beat the Yankees. President Obama's job is to keep us safe, not go to baseball games and do the wave with communist dictators. Doing the way, by going to Argentina and doing the tango, while Americans were still missing and laying maimed in a hospital, while terrorists were still at large, they were showing that we could live our lives. Again, that's fine for Big Poppy or for a dad who takes his kids to see the Red Sox in the Yankees play. It's not fine for the president. It's also not fine to minimize the threat that these terrorists pose to us. I bet a lot of you have hit deer on highways in Arkansas or come close to it. I know I have. one night driving all the way back to Dardanelle, that the deer aren't in the woods plotting how they can kill more of us next time. They aren't trying to get their hands on biological and chemical weapons. They aren't trying to get their hands on nuclear materials. They aren't sending more deer overseas to kill more Americans. That's what terrorists are trying to do. Do Barack Obama's care that threat the Islamic State or Al-Qaeda poses to the safety of American people, the baffling holes or deer collisions, shows just how badly he misunderstands our adversaries and what is necessary to keep this country safe. But it's not just the threat from groups like the Islamic State or Al-Qaeda that the president has consistently underestimated. Look at the Islamic Republic of Iran. The Islamic State is a great threat, but until they have 80 million subjects, until they have a $400 billion economy, until they have a modern military, until they have a vast nuclear infrastructure that can produce a nuclear weapon, the Islamic Republic of Iran will be a greater danger to this country in the long term than the Islamic State is. Now, my objections to President Obama's nuclear deal with Iran are well known. I don't need to repeat them here. I will simply say in short, when Iran, a country that was founded in revolutionary ardor, that invaded our embassy and held dozens of Americans hostage, that still chants death to America on the streets, is given a deal that will put them on the count of nuclear weapons, whether they follow the deal or whether they break the deal, that is a bad deal. And in the meantime, it will give them over $100 billion to continue their reign of terror, not just throughout the Middle East, in places like Iraq and Yemen and Lebanon and Syria, but against Americans. This is a government that has the blood of hundreds of American troops from Iraq and Afghanistan on their hands. I lived that in 2006. We knew when bombs were coming from Iran. We knew that not a single vehicle in the United States military armor, not even an M1 Abrams tank, could withstand it. I've been in the offices of intelligence officers and military officers who have the shrapnel from those weapons to remind them about the Americans who were killed at the hands of Iran. And what does this president do? He says that the rest of the Middle East needs to learn to share with Iran, that they need to be a successful regional power, that they can have $100 billion to continue that reign of terror without changing their ways. And yes, in a mere 10 to 15 years, the blink of an eye in the life of nations, they will have the nuclear weapons capability. What will that look like? Well, you don't have to wonder. All you have to do is look at North Korea. In North Korea, you see the future of Iran. A country that 22 years ago signed a very similar one-sided deal with President Clinton, and that a mere 12 years later detonated a nuclear weapon. A country that is still a Stalinist dictatorship, but is somewhat immune from pressure because they have nuclear weapons, and they now have missiles that can reach the continental United States. And you don't put dynamite or plastic explosives on an intercontinental missile. The only thing you put on it is a nuclear weapon to reach the places like Arkansas and everywhere in between. That's what Iran is going to look like, but only be more dangerous because they are that much closer and they're in the middle of the world, not on the corner of the world. That's exactly what Iran will look like as soon as they get nuclear weapons, whether it's 2 years from now or whether it's 15 years from now. And that's to say nothing of all of the space launches North Korea is undertaking, all of the missile tests they've recently launched, all of the threats and the saber rattling. When I stood on the DMZ last August, looked in the eyes of North Korean soldiers who've been brainwashed since birth to hate America and want to destroy us. And while I'm on the topic of nuclear weapons, there's only one country, of course, in the world that has the capability of any air way of life, and that's Russia, because of their nuclear legacy from the Soviet Union. Vladimir Putin has said the collapse of the Soviet Union was the worst geopolitical disaster of the 20th century. And it's his goal to restore Russia to its past glory. Where would he get the idea that he could do such a thing? Well, in 2008, then-Senator, then-Democratic nominee, President Barack Obama, responded to Russia's invasion of Georgia, a democratic country on the edge of Europe, by calling on both sides to exercise restraint. Think about that. A nuclear superpower invaded a small country of 4 million people, and President Obama called on both sides to exercise restraint. What kind of signal did that send to a man like Vladimir Putin? Is it any surprise when Vladimir Putin invaded Ukraine 2 years ago that the message from the United States government to the Ukrainian government was do nothing provocative? Russian soldiers, paratroopers, special forces were landing in Crimea, and the government of Ukraine was told to do nothing provocative to its anger. Russian soldiers to this day occupy Crimea, they occupy eastern Ukraine, they occupy Moldova, south of Ukraine, they occupy Georgia. They threaten our allies in NATO, consistent overflight and naval traversing, with cyber attacks and other intelligence swirling Eastern Europe. Our NATO allies like Latvia and Estonia spend less on their entire government budget than Russia spends on intelligence alone. And yet what does Barack Obama do? Continue to conciliate with Russia, to cede the Middle East and Eastern Europe to Russia, and give Vladimir Putin every indication that his actions invading a country by a great power for the first time in Europe since World War II will go unresponded to by the United States. Yes, the world is a gravely more dangerous place than it was in here 7 years ago. And that is because Barack Obama's foreign policy has been. But what would be a good policy to reverse that? There's a lot of sophisticated and nuanced ways to approach this. But I could think of a very simple one that would be much better than what Barack Obama's proposed. The Roman General Sulla had it inscribed on his tombstone. It said, no friend has done me a favor, nor enemy an injury, that I have not repaid in full. President Obama doesn't see the world that way. He sees enemies as someone to be negotiated with, conciliated, to grant concessions. Maybe they'll change their ways, despite all the hard-won lessons of the 20th century, despite the lessons of his own administration, from Iran to Russia, Cuba, China, North Korea. He views allies as a burden, as free riders, as someone who's more likely to help get you into war than help deter war from starting in the first place. Look at the way he treats Israel, the only democratic government in the Middle East, our strongest ally, insults their prime minister, imposes terms on them that Palestinians have never even asked for, withholds resupply of critical ammunition in the middle of a shooting war with Hamas terrorists. For their strengths, he's put on allies like Jordan and the United Arab Emirates in their prosecution of the campaign against the Islamic State because they want to be a lot more aggressive than Barack Obama does. His refusal to support a century-old ally, the Philippines, against aggressive Chinese action to assure them that our mutual defense treaty with that country will stand up if China takes aggressive action against them. Time and time again, he viewed allies as someone that can be negotiated away and enemies as someone who can be negotiated with. Well, how should we confront these threats? I would say it's pretty easy with the Islamic State as well. They're not going away. History is not on anyone's side. History is made by men and women. And the only way that we're going to defeat them is to destroy them utterly once and for all. There are 1.6 billion Muslims in the world. The vast majority of them want to live in peace, just like all of us do. They want to have family, they want to have a job, they want to improve their lot in life. But a very small percentage of 1.6 billion people is a very large number of people who hate America and want to kill Americans. And the only solution to that problem is to kill them first before they can reach our shores and kill us here, and to let every one of them know if they join a group like the Islamic State or Al-Qaeda that they will live a miserable life in expectation of death, and that Americans will never live a life like that. For those that we don't kill, they should be captured, and they should be sent straight to Guantanamo Bay. They should be interrogated to the maximum extent of the law, because the last words a terrorist should ever hear is, you have the right to remain silent. As for Iran, very simply, the deal with Iran has to be stopped. It has to be reversed. Sanctions have to be reimposed on Iran. Sanctions have to be imposed on any country or any company that does business with Iran. And Iran has to submit to new terms that we will dictate, the kind of terms that every country around the world That is, after all, what we have done for 75 years. Since our entry into World War II, the United States has been the guarantor of our liberty and our interest in our safety, and the guarantor of global order and stability. And over the last 70 years, we've had to learn the lesson once again that when the United States withdraws from that role, peace and stability is not the natural order of affairs among mankind. Chaos, disorder, violence, and war is the order that occurs when the United States withdraws. And I, for one, am very proud of what the United States has done for 75 years to protect ourselves and to defend global order. Better suited to be the commander-in-chief of our armed forces and to keep this country safe than Hillary Clinton. Not just because of her neglect of handling classified information, it's also because she was the architect of Barack Obama's foreign policy as his Secretary of State. Even though she likes to present herself as the strong, steady, seasoned, experienced hand, spar in face, Hillary Clinton once said that she was the one ready to answer the Meridian phone call. Hillary Clinton had her during the phone call. It was called Benghazi, and she slept through it before Americans died. Right. If you've seen the movie 13 Hours, you should see it if you haven't seen it. You'll know that it's focused very intently on the fighting in Benghazi for those young men and women who are trying to save not only their own lives, but the lives of all those brave other Americans who are there defending our one of the most dangerous cities in the world. Very little about what was happening in Washington, about the politics of what got us there, or the failures that led to this situation for them. Someone asked me if they thought there'd be a sequel to 13 Hours, about what did happen in Washington. And if there was, it'd have to be called 5 minutes, because that's about how much time Hillary Clinton dedicated to that mission and to those men and those women. Our troops, our intelligence officers, our diplomats, our veterans, they deserve a lot better than that. In conclusion here, to show them what we think of them, I just ask a few groups to stand up. First, if you're a veteran of our armed forces, please stand up so we can recognize you. Right now, a husband or a wife who went overseas in the past, mom or dad. If your family member has had someone deployed overseas to a combat zone, please stand up as well so we can recognize your sacrifices. Now, I want to recognize one last group. If you belong to this group and you don't want to stand up, I understand, that's fine. But if you do, please do so we can recognize the fact that your family played the ultimate sacrifice, the Gulf War families, family members who have lost a loved one in combat. Maybe it was a grandfather in World War II. Maybe it was a husband. Maybe it was a wife. Maybe it's been a child in the most recent wars. Someone who's never known what your father looked like. You won't be able to walk your daughter or your son down the aisle at a wedding. You don't know what it's like to grow old with a brother or a sister. I know we have one or two in this room, a possible state. Patriotic as ours, and had so many veterans. You don't have to stand up, but I know it's a very personal thing. And I want to thank you all. I want to thank you all for sacrificing the most precious thing you can, the lives of your loved ones, the defense, the freedom of the United States of America. I want to close with just two stories. Men and women make that sacrifice, contrasting them with the stakes of this election. Between my time in Iraq and Afghanistan, I was at a unit called the Old Guard, the Arlington National Cemetery. That unit performed funerals in the cemetery and ceremonies around the Capitol, Richmond. Unfortunately, they also performed a ceremony called the Dignified Transfer of Remains at Dover Air Force Base. It was soldier, sailor, airman, Marine, or killed in Iraq or Afghanistan, their remains were repatriated to Dover Air Force Base. And we were there to greet them. In 2007, when the body was found, I was at the old guard that was pretty much every night at Dover Air Force Base. As a young officer, I would be the officer in charge. I had a 7-man task team. We'd fly on a Black Hawk at Dover. We'd usually get in the middle of the night because of the time difference between Germany. I would walk up onto a plane as the officer in charge. It was my job to ensure the caskets still had flags on them that hadn't shifted or been damaged. So I'd replace them. We'd move those caskets out onto the vertical loader, and they'd be lowered to the tarmac so those young soldiers could perform the ceremony. And even though it was at Dover, even though it was closed to press and family in those days, even though it was the middle of the night, there was no one there but all of us, those young soldiers in that casket team performed that ceremony at the highest level of care, attention, dignity, and yes, love. Because they knew their fallen comrades deserved that from us. Second story about a similar ceremony at Andrews Air Force Base. If you've seen 13 Hours, you know that at the end of that movie, there were four body bags in the tarmac of Benghazi. The four Americans were killed there. Just 48 hours later, not in the movie, but in real life, they were at Andrews Air Force Base for a ceremony for Secretary of State Clinton. We now know because of that email that she had told about.